and graphifications in their relation to still image counterparts. The last which to Tiplow will give a quick overview of the state of the art in still image recognition, and then we'll have a look at how deep networks can be adapted to computers. And then in particular, I'll talk about different versions, and I'll talk about our recent archive plot, who we proposed to use a string collision network. So, one of the observations which is often used in the crafting of video features is that a video, video can be decomposed into spatial and temporal parts, where spatial part is basically still frames. Captures the appearance, and the temporal part is the motion of the frames. And basically, taking this observation into account, there have been many quite successful features, encountered features for videos, which basically took some features from still image recognition field, and they would adapt and expand these features to videos. But just to give a few examples, it's a hog, which basically stands seat or hog to visual domain, where you have a dimensional volume, space time volume, and you can give the gradients, histogram gradients in this volume. Then there's a hog hog feature, which basically takes this notion into account, where you have a separate hog representation of frames, and you have hog representation on top of them, and then these are intonation across the set of them, which take later. And there's also an aviation snippet, motion boundary histogram, which again computes histograms of motion boundary distances. So all these features, they basically take some ideas from still image recognition field, and then they further extend them and make them work for videos. The same applies not only to the features, not only to the low-level features, but also to the feature encodings, because a typical sort of the shell pipeline, application pipeline, is where you have low-level features first, like SIFT or MBH in case of videos, and then you have encoding, feature encoding, which could be a bag of words or it could be a fish net. And again, these approaches, still image approaches, they were expanded and adapted to speed of the domain. For instance, motion projector cooling, which was shown to perform pretty well on UCF and HMDB datasets. There's also spatial temporal pyramids, which is an extension of spatial pyramids, and so on. But at the same time, in the image recognition field, there was a revolution over the last few years, which basically started in 2012, when the team from Toronto won the Internet Classification Challenge, beating cryptographic features by quite a big margin. And what's interesting here is that from 2012, these deep common architectures, they were improved even further. So for instance, the answers this year, they basically improved on these 2012 results by a factor of 2. So it didn't stop in 2012. These results, the deep network results, they keep on improving. So a natural question to ask is, can we take the deep recognition methods from the image field, still image field, and applied to videos. And there are quite a few challenges, so I'll outline just a few of them here. For instance, the first question to ask is how to incorporate temporal information from videos into the deep representations. Another issue is how to deal with large amounts of data you have. Because, for instance, ImageNet, it contains 1.2 million images per train set. And if you store them as JPEG, they take about 20 gig. And now imagine if you have 1.2 million of videos, then it will take terabytes, millions of terabytes of data. At the same time, if you don't have such amounts of data, such amounts of video data, then basically you're going to have overfitting effects, and overfitting should be mitigated somehow. So these are the challenges we should address. So I'll start with talking about two different families of methods for deep recognition of videos. So these are these two groups. The first is based on just stacking frames one after another. So you have a dimensional volume, sub-volume of a video. Then you use it as an input to a natural language, collision network, which is something else. another group of methods, processes still fate and motion settlement. So you have two kind of strings for your cycle process. Information and cycle process, lot of information. First of all, the first group, which have been around for quite some time, and I guess one of the first approaches was paper at CC 2010, where they took a stack of your frames and like an input to an IBM, which is a multiple machine, in particular towards convolutional IBM. So it's a model which performs a supervised feature learning, so it was learning reader features without supervision, and to perform this application later, you'll take these detailed features, you'll put something on top like SVM or a compass, and then you'll turn it into one on top of it. So previously, this approach was when we did a supervised learning of features, reader features. An obvious extension is to do it in a supervised manner, and this is what was done later, where instead of having RBM, we would have full discriminative end-to-end convolutional network. And when you have this, you basically want a learning machine to infer a special type of features distantly. So you don't specify explicitly image features or logical features. You want the network learned by itself. And there was a very recent work by Kapatia, CPR 2014, which takes that further. And they considered several architectures where you have user-based inputs for compass. So they started with a single frame architecture, which is basically actual specification of still images. And they also looked into different ways of combining multiple frames and stacking them, like self-fusion, early fusion, and so on. In that paper, they also considered two strings, multi-resolution strings, for the center of a frame and the context. And also, the paper is remarkable because it tends to use a large data set of users, 1 million of YouTube sports users. So here's a quick debrief of the results. So what's the most interesting here is that the single frame network, which is essentially an image classification kind of network, which can apply to a number of frames, which performs very well, and the best configuration, which is slow fusion spatial temporal network, it performs just a little bit better. So there could be several reasons for this. It could be the nature of a data set that you can infer the actual bits so well just from frames themselves without looking into the motion. Or it could be that when you try to learn a convolutional network in a conventional manner, it's not like frames, just sort of attempting to pick up spatial features rather than temporal features. So it's going to be an issue of learning precision. I'll get back to this. And the second family is a family of methods which process the spatial information and the temporal information separately. And one of these methods is based on taking an HMARX model. HMARX model is a hand-crafted multi-layer model which is about 200 layers deep. And each layer performs template matching followed by classification of mass. So it's a bit related to the convolutional network, but this one is handcrafted, so it's just trained layer by layer. So let's just do it in one go end to end. So with this kind of architecture, what they did, they had several strings for still frames of motion, which were combined later. But actually, the results of this architecture, I'll say HMDB dataset, not particularly impressive, which could be due to the case that this network is relatively shallow and also is handcrafted, so there's no end-to-end descriptive learning. What we did recently, we proposed a two-string convolution network, which looks like this. So it has two strings, this format. One string is a spatial string, another string is a temporal string. And the idea is that the spatial string is going to take account of the appearance information in the reader, while the temporal string is going to process the motion information. And they have different inputs. Spatial string as an input that takes a still frame of a reader, while the temporal string as an input it takes a bunch of optical flows from the reader within the reader. And in the end, later we have late fusion. In our current Right, so this is sort of the workhorse of our network. This is a common architecture which is going to be used in both each of these districts. So this is a network which is inspired by the top entrants of the last year's internet challenge. If you train this architecture on image net, you're going to get about 13.5% of accuracy, which is quite good. It has 5 convolutional layers and 3 filtering layers. We've also used some other works from our lab. And here we're going to use this for both spatial stream and temporal stream. So I'm going to talk about spatial stream first. So as I said, spatial stream essentially does intensification. It tries to specify action from still frame. And because it's essentially intensification, it has an advantage that you can do a conventional stream of retraining your architecture on a large data set, large people data set, like ImageNet, and then fine tune it on the data data set question by taking frames and images. And at test time, while you kind of must have this architecture to train, at test time, you're going to take a data, you're going to sample all the frames, such as a bunch of frames to sample, 25 frames in each data. You compute the softbox scores for each of these frames, and then you average them to get the final prediction for each box. So now we're moving to the temporal stream components. And as an input, they take an optical flow, a set of optical flows. So they don't take RGB images, just to highlight this. So you can say that optical flow is a set of displacement, optical flow is a set of displacement field between frames in the heater. Just like shown here. So here we have one frame, and for this highlighted area, I have enlarged the displacement field. So it's a depth displacement field which tells which pixel, where the pixel is going to go in the next frame. And because this is basically a vector field, you can take the horizontal and vertical components of this vector field and treat them as two separate scale fields. So that's how it looks like. So this is a short clip from UCF 101 dataset. And here we can use gas optical flow for this one. And here we visualize gas optical components for the flow. This image on the left, because the horizontal flow, positive values mean the surface on the right, negative values mean the surface on the left. Positive values are right here, and negative values are dark, so you can see those. The parts of the hand, which moves right, is obvious right here. And it's similar there where you have vertical flow. So what we can see here is that these fields, these sort of channels, image channels, they have quite a lot of local neighborhood structure, just like RGB images. Because there's a strong local structure, you can take a model which you make use of it, such as one that, and apply to these to perform action. Right. So we use tensor flow, as I've said, and it is scaled to 0 to 255 range. As I've said, it's for 2 components. Right, so now the question is, we have these desktop flows computed over the whole window. So for each frame we know, kind of whole flow, let's say, so we know for each frame, for each pixel, where the pixel is going to go in the next frame. And the question is now how to combine these flows, these two components which I showed before, how to combine them into a convolutional network input. So the most simple thing to do would be just to take for each frame these two components, two channels, and treat as an input, as a two channel input. But obviously, one can extend it and stack a few flows one after another. And this is one of the inputs which you consider. So here we show that, let's say, for this point V1, we have different displacement vectors over time, and then we stack them into the input for the network. So this is pretty straightforward, we just stack optical flows one after another. Another approach, which is inspired by the less common checkup features, makes use of the checkers. So here we start at the same point, V1, but then we follow the trajectory which starts from V1 and goes further into V2. And instead of stacking the displacement vectors at point V1, one to another, and then V4, here we follow the trajectory and stack these parts of the trajectory is our aim. But actually, as we'll see later, doing this does not lead to any better results than just simple technological curves long term. Another issue which should be considered is that of global motion or camera motion. In the works of shallow physicists, it's been highlighted that it's important to estimate, sometimes explicitly estimate, the global camera motion, because if you don't do this, you can just run to learn and it's just applies. So the logic approach is how to do this. In our work, we do something very simple. For each frame, we compute the mean of the flow vector, and we subtract this mean from the whole vector of the frame. So it has this sort of nice global motion cancellation effect, and also it makes our optical flow vectors zero-centered. And zero-centered is important for the chain convolution network multiplication layers. Right, so I've described, what our temporal stream model is about. And here we compare this, we can count the features. So let's say there's a trajectory feature, and basically the input to our component is explicitly this trajectory feature. It's an explanation of trajectory vectors along the trajectory. Other features like MBH, or let's say PowerPoint D, they can also be seen as special cases of our architecture. For instance, in the case of MBH, which is the system of our gradients, it can be seen as a single layer of convolution layer network, which contains our intentions, sensor filters, flow verification, and so by having this sort of generalization code that wants to learn this architecture in a completely data-driven way, you get better results than the branch of GTU type applications. And just to confirm what I just said, here I visualize the first convolutional layer filters. In the first convolutional layer, we have 96 filters, and these filters are shown in columns. So the first column, the first filter, the last column is 96 filters. And we do it for the case where we stack together 10 optical flows. In that case, we have 20 channels, because 20 optical flows give us 10 optical flows give us 10 horizontal components and 10 vertical components. And these correspond to rows. So here, what I show is actually a transposed column just to make the visualization better. So these two filters, as you can see, they're basically computed on time derivatives. They can be first order derivative across time, so they capture how motion changes over time. In this case, we have a spatial derivative filters. So these filters capture how motion changes in space across the frame. And this is completely data-driven. So in particular, these filters, they're sort of similar to what MBH descriptor is doing, but this is in completely data-driven manner. Right, and basically, low-level features were only a part of the story. Another part of the story is that typically in a shallow architecture, on top of low-level features, you have feature encoding. And to the bottom level, the convolutional networks basically perform a very discriminative deep sort of encoding of the features handled by the first layers. Because each layer of the convolutional network performs linear operation followed by multiplication of multiple layers. So it can be seen as a very discriminative feature. So it's also sort of generalization of encoding methods which we have in shallow features. But as I mentioned before, if there's not enough training data, there's going to be an issue of quality time. And in this work, we consider two data sets. You see F101 and the changes in English are relatively small, especially compared to English, which has 1.2 million images. So we had to zoom the overview format somehow. There are these additional tricks of where, for instance, you take each video, you can take different subcards of this video, which has data augmentation. But this is not enough. So we used a very aggressive dropout here. We used a dropout of 90%, well, typically for image identification, we use 80% dropout. As I mentioned, we used a dropout. And one thing we should actually do here is multitask learning, because we have two data sets, and there are different ways of training a model to data set, or several data sets. And what we do here is loss task running in general is running a model based on several loss functions for different tasks. But in our particular case, all our tasks are classification tasks. It's just that one task is to classify readers from the UCM data set, another task is to classify readers from the GMT data set. So this kind of looks like we have our component, and we then have two final softmax layers, where one layer performs UCF classification, another layer performs GMDBP type classification, and each of these classifiers is equipped with its own loss. And we can do a backdrop chaining just as before with these two loss functions. So the final loss is the sum of these two sum losses. Right, so before we go to the results, let's have a look at the implementation details. So we train this architecture with mini batch SGD. For this, we have our own custom version of the Kafka toolbox, which in particular allows us to perform chain on multiple GPUs. So we train these models on 4 GPUs and it takes about a day to do it. But it's also because the data sets are quite small. And as far as optimal flow is concerned, we can get optimal flow to the fast GPU implementation of Box methods put to CV04. There's one issue with optimal flows is that if you, okay, it's very fast because it's GPU implementation, but still it's not fast enough to do it on the fly. So you have to compute it. And if we compute optimal flows, even for an ultimate model size, this that's, sorry. Even for an ultimate small data set like UCF, if you compute optimal flow and try to store it in a single position, it will take 1.5 terabytes. So what we do here, we convert real scale optimal flow displacement vectors to the range from 0 to 55, rounded to signed bits, and then we use JPEG lossy compression to compress our optimal flows. And this trick reduces the size from 1.5 terabytes to 27 gig. And 27 gig is manageable, you can put it on SSD disk, you can put it into main memory, so it's all that fast. So this is one important trick to make this whole thing work, because otherwise you'll have a big bottleneck in reading these optimal flows from the disk. Right, so let's recap, we have these two streams in our architecture. So in relation, I'll start with measuring the performance of each of these streams separately, and then we'll have a look at the performance of the whole architecture once we use predictions. And as I mentioned, the data sets we use UCF 101 and HDB 51. And we use standard relation protocol, which is used by the operators. Okay, so this is the performance of the spatial stream, and here we report the accuracy of the first split of UCF 101. So the main observation here is that we're training the spatial stream on the ImageNet dataset is important. There's not much in between keeping the features fixed, the features which are learned on ImageNet, and train just the last layer of network versus maintaining all layers. The difference is very small between these two. But both of these approaches, they significantly outperform training the network from scratch in the CFO. By the way, when you train it from scratch on a small data set, again, using 90% per cloud helps a lot, but still it doesn't make the results as good as they are when you're training your features on each other. And this is a sample stream. The key observation here is that increasing the number of optical flows which is stuck into your final input is important. So if you just start with a single optical flow, you get some quite decent performance, but it gets much better when you stack 5 optical flows or 10 optical flows. Up to 10 optical flows is also a rich point situation, so there's no point in, but this is our architecture, there was no point in doing more than 10 optical flows to make it slow. And also, the mean subtraction helps, because as I discussed before, it sort of cancels out the effect of global motion, but it helps not that much as bottlenecks. So the key thing here to make temporal streams work is to stack lots of optical flows as you input. And also, as you can see, doing the checker stack where you stack your optical, when you stack your second batch to one with the checker, it does not give any improvement compared to just stacking to the first one to another. Right, and these are the results of the multitask log formulation. here we consider a scenario where we have HMDB listener, which is smaller than UCF101. And we want to utilize UCF101 data set in a chain model for HMDB. And that's different ways of doing this. One way would be to train on UCF first, and then fine-tune on HMDB. But the issue is, if you train a network on a small data set, then you fine-tune it on another small data set, then you can have one of these two issues. One issue occurs when it comes to low learning rates. It means that in the future we will stay specialized to a further small learning data set. Or you can use large learning rates. But in that case, your features, your network will become specialized to the new data set, so it will work better. So the fine-tuning is not really locked off here. It's just a bit better than HMDB from scratch, but still, you can get much better performance if you combine these two data sets in a more appropriate manner. So one way to combine them is to merge the two data sets into one. But if you merge different data sets into one, there's an issue of semantic overlap between classes. For instance, if one of your data sets has a class jump, another one has a class high jump, then it's not clear how to merge these two. And in this experiment, basically, we're going to merge an UCF101 and an HMDB51. In this case, we just dropped the classes where there was that kind of an overlap. It's not clear how to merge them properly. But if you use multi-tasking learning, you don't have to deal with merging data sets. You just have a separate loss function for each of these two. And the difference from here, performance is the best of all these things. And it's about 9% improvement compared to just training HMDB from scratch. Right, and this is the comparison with state of the art with different types of methods on UCF and HMDB. As you can see, when we combine our spatial stream and temporal stream, we improve performance on each of these. So it's important to combine these streams, and even a simple combination, just by averaging, helps a lot. And if you use weighted averaging, where you have a higher weight for the temporal stream, you get slightly better results. So there's some hope that when you do, when you have lots of training data, you can train a proper late fusion. Let's say by having a few convolutional network layers, two network layers, which probably use these two strings to sort of final result. And we also compare with the previous attempts of using deep nets for action recognition, which is spatial temporal HMARCs, and slow fusion network, pertaining or supports on our data sets. So there's a question of why does the slow fusion network perform not as well. It could be just different reasons. One reason could be that it's just the nature of the data set, the sports on the data set, but when you fine-tune the network on UCF, you get performance significantly worse than state of the art. Another reason could be that when you stack frames together and you try to learn the network using stack frames, as I said before, it could be that the learning procedure is trained on spatial features or temporal features. So maybe we need to make some changes to the training procedure to make it account for both spatial and temporal domain. But in our case, we do it explicitly. We just split our video into spatial and temporal domain and a couple different models for each of this. And here we also report the results by the first kind of the features. So the state of the art of UCF101 is still by that's checklist and lots of kind of dimensional encoders which are fused together. And as far as HMDB1 is concerned, as far as I know, the best result is reported by this C paper, which actually uses an architecture known as Deep Feature Network. So this is an architecture which we proposed at last NIPS, and we used it back then for image classification, and we got some pretty good results back then on ImageNet. It was worse than the convert, but better than Fisher Vector. And it's quite nice to see that some people have taken it to the video domain and got like the results. But the hope is that once we move from these out to the small data sets like UCF and the HMDB, something large like sports one or the beyond this, we should be able to improve on the deep network results. Because right now it is pretty much like trying to learn a convolution network, let's say on Caltech to 6 data sets compared to Fisher Vector. You can get good results if you train a convert on Caltech to 6. It won't be as good as the same Fisher Vector. But once you have ImageNet at your side, you can put a training layer and then get much better results. So in conclusion, one can get very good results if you train a convolution network and multiple flow data. and here we propose total architecture, which makes use of this. We split a video stream into two parts, spatial part and temporal part, and for each of these have a separate format which performs recognition. And the future work, as I mentioned before, is to make use of large data and also to have a look at how to properly combine these two streams. Here we had to use averaging because of the overfitting issues. But once you have lots of data, you can have a whole lot of data specifically to learn how to merge these. Or you can do a backlog for the format. That's it. Thanks for your time. So there was some papers recently. There's a deep law paper that's published, which proposed a deep architecture, which is not exactly a compass, but it was deep architecture for optical flow estimation. So one can also see, obviously, optical flow problem as a sort of a deep regression problem. So it should be possible. Again, if you have enough data and you have a rotation, let's say. So yeah, I think it should be possible. So here we use this box method of CO4 as a very sort of a generic method without many tricks, which is based on some generic assumptions of what you can use as humans. So we believe that by using this optical flow method, it's not really much complicated. But obviously, one can see optical flow as a prediction problem. So I didn't try to flow but on optical flow benchmarks and stuff that are as well. Channels. in the inputs only affect the number of parameters in the first line. But yeah, I agree that's what you said.
So you use your own drivers and your combinations?
No, I use the valve only for the last three parameters.
The main question, so it seemed that the compared results were still just frames of motion that network work is when you train for scratch network work is much like much more to images. Mm-hmm. Right. And when you train for scratch, the flow doesn't work as much.
Well,
so this way.
Well, for example, that we can buttons compare with. For spatial, spatial one, we can come we can have a look at this result. Yes, so we can have a look at this result from scratch versus the training on the internet. And you can see that there's a big gap. But once you compare, let's say this, we don't have a sort of an ImageNet like image scale data for meters. So there's sports one end, but we can trust one end.
Sure, but absolute numbers are
really nice. Okay. Yes, but it could be that once we have a very huge, very nice data set of very diverse meters, you can get maybe 90% here. So we just don't know at this moment how far we can push this for data, how far we can push this for data.